Welcome to Show and Tell with the Two Mortgage Guys. We come to you live on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and LinkedIn every Tuesday at noon. Today, we've got Chrissy Hitchcock, Realtor with the key team at the Hardie Group. And today, we're going to do some do's and don'ts about selling your house. You don't want to miss it. Stick around.
Joining us today is Chrissy Hitchcock, Realtor with the Key Team at the Hardie Group. Beginning her career in real estate in 2013, Chrissy is known for her passion to help people and her commitment to make each and every experience a great one. She was born in South Suburbs of Chicago and moved to Kokomo during her teenage years, where she still resides with her husband and children today. Aside from her passion for real estate, her and her family enjoy the gym, fitness competitions, traveling, and finding adventures together. Welcome to the show, Chrissy.
Hi, guys.
Hey, hey.
Sorry, I left for a second there. I hit my hand down on the keyboard and I was gone.
Right. Disappeared. Good having you again. This will be fun. I said, okay. Good having you again.
Thanks.
Yeah. Yes. We had you on the show early on. This is our 35th episode.
I know. I love your shows.
It's great. Well, we appreciate it. We're always looking for, relevant things to talk about, mortgage, real estate. We thought today we'd spend some time with you and just go through the process of selling a home. I mean, it's not just a matter of making a phone call. I mean, people ask us all the time, like, things they should and shouldn't do. So I'm just going to, the very first question is, what's the very first thing you should do if you're thinking about selling your home?
There's lots of things that should be done first. And I think having the guidance from a seasoned agent is probably the most important thing for a seller, so that way they're not blinded by things like not having a pre-approval, what to focus on in their home. So really, overall, to start, they really need to get a good agent.
Yeah. And we've got your information up here if you need one, right? So if somebody doesn't know who to call.
And on that, like, so one of the things, like when Ryan was bringing into that part with, and it's like the when the people decide they're like, hey, I'm going to sell my house. Like, that's where, like you said, yourself, a realtor going in there to be able to help sort of like look at it, or maybe quote unquote stage it. Is that some of that stuff you guys do with them, on talking conversation, then a look at the house?
We my team handles a lot of that as far as like staging. We offer so many different things, but I think part of the biggest issue as a seller, what I come across for most people, even if they've sold a house before, because things change year to year, sometimes they change month to month. The biggest thing is just guiding them on what they need to do first. Anywhere from the pre-approval process to making sure when somebody walks up to the front door, they're not overwhelmed by your decorations, or making sure that the toys are out of the yard and they have a good first impression. A lot of things that as an owner, you don't think about, cleaning your vents, stuff like that, all the way to, making sure that your finances are straight and you can buy another house when you sell.
Right. You don't want to do that and end up homeless, right?
Or we have rentals for that. Yeah. It won't be homeless. It might be a year or so before they can buy again. But the biggest, obstacle sometimes in buying, especially in the market in the last couple of years, is having to sell a house. So if that's a step they have to take, I've had sellers that have done that.
Right.
Let's talk about some specifics. Like, what are some common things that maybe you should be doing around the house that will make a difference, right? I mean, because you mentioned earlier, like, personal stuff and decluttering and some light cleaning. But, we've all talked to clients in the past that are just freaked out over it. I mean, we have clients freaked out over having an appraiser come visit, let alone putting it on the market. So, like, what should you be focusing on? Or is that something that you do specific to a home? But I mean, like, give us some generic stuff that people should do.
There's two things that are missed a lot of times, and they just really show a potential buyer on how the home's been cared for. So if I walk up to a house and the gutters are full and they're growing trees, then to me that's saying, okay, they're not maintaining the outside of their home. You know, all that weight can cause some damage to the gutters down the line. So it's simple stuff like that, just making sure that, you know, the house is maintained for when they do go through the inspection, they're not surprised. And then making sure that the furnace is clean. It has a clean furnace filter, you know, cleaning the fans and the vents, just little things like that, that buyers will look at if they're not maintaining the obvious things. Are they maintaining the big items, the big ticket items, you know? So that's right. As far as clutter, some buyers don't care. I just tell people you have to live in your house. People do expect you to live in your house, but if you do have to declutter, nicely stack it in the garage, because that's the place that people expect to see,
you know, extra boxes stuff, and, right.
Yeah, big stuff.
Yeah, so that's good. So like having the garage space, that's one of the things when you were talking about that, like decluttering, like even if, let's say their garage is just, they got to keep their cars in it or whatever, other areas, do you have other suggestions for them? Like say, hey, you know, call U-Haul, get temporary small storage or something to put stuff in. Just to make it a little bit less cluttered in their house.
Well, and it really makes sense. And I the way to present it to a buyer or to a seller is that you're going to be packing up to move anyway. So what is it that you don't need right now? You know, I don't suggest to take everything off the walls, but you know, if there's extra stuff that you don't need right now, you're halfway done packing. You can pack it up, put it in storage for a couple months, and then it's not so overwhelming when you do sell.
Yeah. Good call. Yeah. I said it's that stuff like you don't think of, because it's depending on the season, right? You don't need your winter coats and stuff. You can put that stuff. That takes up a lot of space.
Right.
We did that in our last house. You know, we, my wife and I and our kids, we lived it for 18 years. So, you know, we accumulated a lot of stuff in that home.
Right.
And it was never like cluttered, but I wanted to make it seem as big as I could. And it's like you just said, I knew we were going to move stuff anyways. So we boxed up various things and took to a storage unit, and honestly it cost us like 1 month's worth of storage, but our house looks so much bigger by doing that, you know what I mean, just by really straightening up the bedrooms and the garage. Specifically my garage, I had so much stuff in that garage, it's unbelievable,
you know,
getting it out of there.
And honestly, when we bought our house 6 years ago, I did the same thing, and I had a lot of stuff in the garage. And I can tell you that 95% of that stuff did not make it to my new house. I didn't because I learned to love to live with less.
Yeah, right.
And it was it's a lot easier to clean when you don't have the clutter. You just don't realize it.
So I'm gonna throw some things out there. Tell me if it matters. Like, should I be worried about replacing carpet? I got carpet in the house. Should I worry about carpet?
Well, if you're selling your house at the top of the market and you're expecting top dollar for your house and the carpet is completely destroyed, it may make or break your sale. It's not going to add much value to your home, but it does help the sellability of it. Okay. Some buyers are okay with replacing carpet if they have the means to. So it's really a case to case.
Depends how bad it is, right?
Right.
Because I feel like a lot of people, that's maybe one of the things they do anyways, is painting and flooring. Because my next question was going to be painting. You know, I feel like a lot of people think, oh man, I got to repaint. You know, I haven't painted in years and we're going to sell it. We want to spruce it up. And I'm sure it does look a little cleaner after a fresh paint job, but it's kind of a personal thing, right?
It is. You know, there's like estate situations. They don't always have the means to paint a house. And a lot of the elderly have lived in their homes for years and years, and you take the pictures down and you start packing and you realize that there's, you know, grandma lit candles and there's black marks around the pictures that you never noticed before. You know, in a situation like that, if you have a couple hundred dollars and you can go paint it yourself, I would paint it.
Yeah.
It could, on that point, exactly. Like it's not, I mean, again, a gallon of paint's more expensive now than what it used to be, but you can still pick one up for $35, $40 for a gallon of paint. It doesn't take very many gallons to paint a room or two.
Right. And the thing is, again, it doesn't add value, but it really does help sell. You know, you see people, sellers, you see them give a credit for flooring allowance, but they are not going to give credit for a painting allowance usually.
Yeah.
And then on that, what do you, is there like, if somebody's doing that, like Ryan said, carpet paint or something, is there like more of a generic color that you recommend if somebody's doing that, like a base, or is it just depend on their preference again, because it's their house?
Well, I tell people my favorite color to use when you're not going to live there anymore. It's actually the color I used in my own house because it's so neutral. It's called grayish. So if somebody wants to go with gray in their house, they can go with gray. If they want to go with tan, they can go with tan. It's right down the middle and it goes with both. And it's the perfect color that's neutral that most people will like.
Good. What's it called again?
Grayish.
Grayish. Yeah. Yeah. Cause you always wonder that, right? Cause somebody like, I don't know what that next person would look at when they walk into that house.
Yeah. And most people will move in and paint anyway, but I think it's more of the presentation of the home that matters. You know, if there's black boxes on the wall from where pictures were, that for a lot of people, that's a turnoff.
Right.
From a lending perspective, you know, if your buyer's potentially using government financing like FHA or VA or USDA, there's things that you may want to take a look at on your own property before you sell it, just to make sure that you don't exclude those buyers. Chipped and peeling paint, interior and exterior, that can be a big deal. And here's the thing, if you don't do it before you sell and then someone comes along with an attractive offer and it's FHA, you might be in a position where you have to do it anyways.
Right.
Just making sure, like you mentioned earlier, you know, the furnace filter, but just making sure your furnace works, your electrical, the water, the basic stuff. Those are probably the biggest things we come across. And with VA loans, maybe some safety things, you know, are there handrails where there should be handrails on steps? But that could probably make a big difference for the potential buyer that you can now accept, right? Because now
you don't have to come with cash. A lot of sellers will ask if they should do an inspection prior to listing. I don't suggest it. They're expensive. There's a lot of things that we can see if you pick the right agent to walk through the home with you. Like you said, a seasoned agent is going to know that there can't be chipping and peeling paint. You know, some sellers have the opinion that they'll just wait. I strongly suggest not to wait, because then a buyer will start picking. You know, if there's if there's 80 pages because you had chipping and peeling paint versus 30 to 50 pages, you know, it's really what you see, and then let the inspection happen by the buyer.
Yeah. So as far as, okay, I need to know what I should sell my house for, right? I mean, you're going to advise me on that. I mean, do you give me something that kind of gives me an idea of what I should expect as far as fees and commissions and all that?
Yeah. So we can do a net sale sheet for the seller. You know, it's funny that you brought that up, because in this market right now, and we just had a meeting about this at the Hardie Group, but in this market right now, it's really hard to pull comps. Because even what a house sold for 6 months ago may not be what a house is selling for right now, you know. But if you pull comps from 2 years ago, you're probably listing it too low. So this is what I tell my sellers. We pull comps. They have to list where they feel comfortable listing. And then we give them the rest of the fees that they can expect as far as, you know, the title fees and stuff like that, making sure that they know what their payoff is, or that if there's any other liens attached to the home, you know, weed cut liens or anything.
Right.
And we need that from the lending side. If we've got clients, like we get a lot of repeat clients. Hey, Ryan, I'm talking to Chrissy. I'm going to sell my house. I want to get pre-approved for another one. I mean, one of the things we need to know from a lending perspective is, all right, what are you going to make on your home, right? How much money do you have? What are we going to do with that, with your equity? Are you using that for down payment? Are we paying off other debts? So it's very helpful for us to kind of know, you know, approximately what they're going to get. And somebody who's thinking about selling on their own, they don't always know that. They have no idea what to expect. They don't know how to list it.
And sometimes there's a few surprises, you know, sometimes they didn't realize a true story. I had a situation where there was a cosigner that had a bad debt that attached to my seller's house, and she had no idea, you know. So it's, I like to do my own research to go through and look at their case, You know, there's a lot of information we can find online before it does get to closing.
Yeah,
or right. Go through title. So, you know, if you have an agent that's working for you and really wants you educated, hopefully they're doing those little extra things that help.
Yeah.
Like you said, that's a good point. Cause like, you don't always know, right? Like that co-signer, the person that was going right. on title knew that everything was good there, but it's not something that you just normally sometimes even know that it might be there. Right.
And it can be very devastating. It can be very devastating.
Yeah. Yeah, we've seen it on the other end where everything's rolling and we're getting, you know, moving along. All of a sudden, it's like, hold on, we got a seller issue, and then we just sort of wait because it's not sometimes real quick. But
those are not fun.
Right.
So, Chrissy, the market's changed. It's not what it was in the middle of the summer. But you know what should a buyer or a seller expect today if they've got a home that's priced fair? It's not a crazy unique property. I mean, what should they expect as far as, you know, what they're going to get versus what they're asking and how long it might take to move it?
You know, I would say right now that the properties are probably sitting a little longer than they were. Most homes, even now through the holidays, are still getting an offer within 30 days. Yeah. But you know, the way that I would present it to a seller is you got to look at the location and you have to look at the condition and price it accordingly. In any market, if you price your home fair per the condition, it's going to sell within a reasonable amount of time.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's right. It's like knowing that you can do that it's not a big deal. Right. So you can get that same thing where you've got your houses and you've got them set up and move through the process. So.
Right. Right. And there, every house is sellable. Literally every house is sellable. You just have to make sure that you're aware, you know, if you're selling it as is, you need to price it and make sure it's as is, you know, just because John Doe down the road sold the same property, same square footage with the same land for $350,000. Well, he had granite countertops and, you know, and he redid the kitchen and the bathrooms. And that doesn't mean you can sell mom and dad's estate for $350,000 that hasn't been updated in 30 years.
Right. So it's not just, it's what's inside, not necessarily just a picture you see on the outside or the address.
Right.
Of the house.
Yeah. And all that stuff is important. You know, when you're working with somebody, there's no question that's a dumb question. So I love for people to ask those questions, you know, to go walk the property and really give them my honest feedback. You know, I've lost listings because I've given that honest feedback, and I would rather lose a listing and let them know that, you know, this is where I see it. You can list where you want. This is what I see you need to do. This is what I wouldn't do. You know, a lot of people think they should just paint their cabinets. Well, I mean, that's not going to really add value either.
Yeah.
Wipe them down. Make sure the property's clean. Make sure the furnace is clean. Make sure the gutters are clean.
A little bit of elbow grease sometimes.
Yes, goes a long way. Yeah. It does. It goes a long way.
Yeah. But like you said, people, that's that big stuff now. Like people do that, like painting cabinets. I mean, you know, 10 years ago, I don't think I really heard of people painting cabinets like they do nowadays, but they look good. But like you said, it's dependent on what you're going to do. And are you going to get a return on your investment? Is it just better to clean it up than it is to paint it? Because somebody might like the natural wood if that's what they are.
I say replace the leaky toilet before you paint the cabinets.
Yeah. Yeah, a little punch list, all right? Things that sort of like on priorities, like you said, it's almost like because like for Ryan and I on the lending side, we really don't usually see the home inspection because that's all sort of done ahead of time since it's not required. But there's from time to time, we'll have a client that'll be in the office that'll have their home inspection report. They're pretty detailed.
They're very
you know, as it goes through on that. But it's like you said earlier, you know, if you get it and it's 100 pages long, it's going to take a little bit longer to go through that than if it's 50. So if you can pick out some of these little things here and fix a leaky toilet or an outlet here or cabinet hinge or something like that, narrows that list down a lot.
Right. And one thing I like to do when I meet with my sellers, if it's a seller that is overwhelmed by the process, I get my cell phone out and I make a list on my own phone, you know, what they need to do, what's important for them. So getting with a lender, making sure that their finances are straight, getting a net sheet together so they have to get me their payoff. And then I go around and make a list of what they need to do in their home to get it ready to sell. So then I send that list to them and they can check it off as they go. And that way they're not so overwhelmed, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've covered some good stuff here today, Chrissy. I hope this has been helpful for anybody that's thinking about putting their home on the market, whether it's next week, next year, whenever it is, having a starting point is super helpful. But we cannot let you go without at least knowing, like, what's the number one thing on your Christmas wish list this year? I mean, it's just around the corner.
You know, we have not really done big gifts in probably 4 years.
Yeah.
So what we do every year is we take our kids on a surprise either date or trip.
Oh, that's awesome.
So this year is our first year that we have to split up in groups because my older kids have other things going on, college and businesses and whatever. So my little guy, is his biggest dream is, anybody who knows me knows that I love Jamaica. That's my place. That is my favorite place on earth. Unfortunately, we cannot take him to Jamaica, but we're settling for second best, which is Gina's favorite. So we're surprising them with a trip to the Bahamas.
Oh, nice. Awesome. Yeah. That'd be really
cool. I guess my biggest wish is to make sure that my kids get to travel and see the world and appreciate that over the material things.
Heck yeah, that's awesome. And those are memories that they'll always have.
I'm excited.
Yeah.
Our kids still bring up the trips we've done to Mexico and, you know, they don't forget that stuff.
No.
Well, that's awesome.
Good. And I'm an older mom. So, you know, an Xbox is only going to be played for so long, but, you know, getting to see the fish in the sea like he's dreaming of will be just something he'll never forget.
That's pretty cool.
So.
Good stuff. Chrissy, thanks so much again for popping back on with us and giving us a little bit of your knowledge. We appreciate it. So if everybody's like this, make sure you like it, share it, comment. If you have any questions, reach out. We'll make sure Chrissy gets the information and gets back to you guys on it.
You guys have a great Christmas.
Great. Thanks.
Thanks again, Chrissy.
Yep, you bet.
All right. Next week, we're going to be talking with Erica Hawkins and Melissa Reed. We'll be covering the 2022 year-end review, and boy, has it been a fun one. From rising mortgage rates, increasing property values, the seller's market, and more. We'll update you on where we've been, where we are, and our predictions for what we'll see in 2023. We'll see you next week.